Today we'll talk about two new additions to the MX-10K multi-service edge router, the LC4800 and LC4802 LAN cards. These cards complete the portfolio alongside with the existing LC480 and LC9600, and they bring some really interesting capabilities to the platform. Before detailing the two new LAN cards, let's have a quick look at the previously available options for MX chassis. First, we had the LC480. It was based on two 304 packet forwarding engines. It offers 48 SFP ports where you can insert 1 gigi or 10 gigi optics. And you get the naming logic, 48 times 10 gig, that's 480 gigabits per second. The second option was addressing another market, the need for dense 400 gigi MSC. With the LC9600, we stacked 6 306 NPU to offer 24 ports at 400 gig. That's also 96 ports, 100 gig, with breakout cable and channelization. And for many years, with these two cards, we answered needs from 1 gig to 400 gig, but we didn't have any native 100 gig port options. Both LC4800 and LC4802 are here to address this gap. Like the LC9600, they are powered by the 306 PFE, our true run-to-completion ASIC. They deliver 4.8T of forwarding capability, support Class C timing, they offer MACsec on all ports at line rate, and more recently we introduced inline IPsec support if you prefer that type of encryption technology. Now, the key differences between these two cards is the port configuration, and this video will cover these aspects into a lot of details. But in a nutshell, the LC4800 focuses on high density with SFP56DD and QSFP56DD ports, while the LC4802 provides more compatibility but slightly less port density with QSFP28 and also QSFP56DD combinations. Both are supported in the 4-slot and 8-slot chassis as long as they are equipped with the SFP2 switching fabric cards, the minimum release being the Junos 24.2R1 and 25.2R1 for the LC4802. Let's start with a deep dive into the architecture. At the heart of both LAN cards, you will find three 306 chipsets. They are called internally YT. This is a 7-nanometer process node forwarding ASIC with a core clock frequency of 1.2 GHz that can push 1.6T of traffic per chipset. The 306 package is made actually of two data paths. They are seen as PFE0 and PFE1 from Junos operating system's perspective. We have 36 SerDes lanes to the fabric and 32 SerDes lanes toward the WAN interface and half for each data path. Each WAN service can be programmed at different speeds, up to 56 gigabits per second. That's why we support interfaces up to 400 gig. This run-to-completion architecture, assisted by multiple hardware accelerators, is essential to deliver both performance and programmability. We will dedicate a full video to the life of the packet. And if you didn't do it already, I strongly suggest the read of this really good article David Roy published on 306 packet workflow. Since each 306 package has two PFEs and we have three chipsets per LAN card, we get a total of six PFEs from the Junos perspective, as it is illustrated in this CLI output. You can see here the six PFEs, each capable of 800 gig, that gives us a total of 4.8T of forwarding capacity. Now let's look at the LC4800 specifically. The card is composed of multiple boards. First, we have the baseboard. This connects to the fabric cards and hosts the free 306 chipset along with many other components. Then we have the processor mezzanine board. It connects to the baseboard and hosts an AMD CPU with a total of 32 GB of DDR memory. The 8 cores are clocked at 2.5 GHz. And it will deal with functions like local logs and syslog, the sampling like S-flow and J-flow, the MACsec key exchanges, and many other bandwidth-intensive applications like the exception traffic handling and, of course, HARP. Third, the WAN mezzanine board connects to the baseboard and hosts the WAN interface and all the QSFP and SFP gauges. They are installed in a belly-to-belly design mode, that means on top and bottom of the board. We call this also a sandwich design. So the LC4800 has a fixed layout with 4 QSFP56DD and 40 SFP56DD ports spread in multiple cages. The QSFP56DD ports support from 4x10GB to 400GB, and the SFP side will support from 1GB to 100GB. So each trio PFE handled one logical pick. So we have them numbered from 0 to 2. Picks 0 and 1 are mapped to 2 QSFP-DD and 12 SFP ports, while the pick 2 is mapped to 16 SFP ports. Using breakout and channelization, a slot with an LC4800 will support up to 48 ports, 100GB. In this first example, we use 400GB optics in the QSFP56DD slots. When you set that type of optics in the port 00, the system automatically disables the ports 0/2 and 0/4 because they belong to the same port Grumman slice. This gives us 4 ports of 400GB and 32 ports of 100GB, a total capacity of 4.8T. In this other configuration, we support 44 times 100GB. 4 of them will be QSFP28 optics, while the 40 others will be SFP56DD optics. No ports are disabled with this configuration. Another last example using QSFP28DD, that's a 2x100GB optics, and we have them in the 4 QSFP slots. In this case, we have a total of 48 ports of 100GB available, 8 via the 4 2x100 optics, and the rest on the SFP56DD optics. Again, no need to disable ports here. Why picking SFP56DD and not QSFP28 form factor for this LC4800? The SFP56DD uses two surges at 50GB to the hot side, compared to the QSFP28, which uses four surges at 25GB. The SFP56DD form factor occupies 114 square millimeters compared to the 156 that we need for QSFP. That's a 33% density improvement. So the benefits are significant. More density, potentially we can get 48 times SFP56DD ports in one IU. Port flexibility, because we have the native support now from 1GB SFP to 100GB that doesn't require any type of adapter, and we can save up to 25% when we compare to the QSFP28 single lambda optics. But it comes with an important restriction. You cannot connect your existing 4 lambda optics, like your LR4, your QSFP28 LR4, to these SFP-DD cages. Indeed, the SFP56DD only supports single lambda optics. So if you specifically need LR4 connectivity, you must use only the QSFP ports that's gonna give you 4 ports, or maybe 8 if you are using the mini CS connectors that we have on the QDD 2x100 LR4. Let's talk about the LC4802. The overall architecture is very similar to its predecessor. Same number of chipset or packet forwarding engine, same processor mezzanine board, same 4.8T of forwarding capacity. The key difference will be in the WAN mezzanine board and the port configuration. The LC4802 will use 32 QSFP28 ports instead of the 40 SFP56DD that we had on the LC4800. On this previous card, we had 3 picks, and that's the same here. Picks 0 and 1 are mapped to 2 QSFP-DD and 8 QSFP28 ports, and the pick 2 is mapped to 16 QSFP28. The QSFP-DD ports support the same speed that we had on the LC4800, but the QSFP28 have a different capacity set. They support 1GB to 10GB with QSA adapter, 4x10, 4x25, 40, and 100GB. Now, when using 100 gigabit Ethernet optics in the QSFP28 port, a PHY configured in reverse gearbox mode will multiplex the 4x25 gigabits per second lanes to the cage into 2x50GB towards the PFE. This works great, and all the ports can be active. However, for 40GB, 4x10, and 4x25, the situation is different. The 10GB and 25GB links cannot be multiplexed between RT and PFE. They require distinct lanes on both sides of the PHY. That means one port out of two must be disabled to accommodate this type of ports. In the system, we created port pair groups. That's the list you can see here from for the pick 0 and 1. And for the pick 2, you have also the pair here, 0, 2, 1, 3, etc. And finally, up to 13 and 50. If you insert 40 gig, 4x10 or 4x25 gig optic in one port of a pair, the other port of that pair will be automatically disabled. So you can mix and match, for example, using 100 gig on some ports and 40 gig on some others, as long as you respect the pairing constraints. So on both cards, the naming convention is the same. You will use GE for 1 gigabit Ethernet, XC for 10, and ET for everything from 25 to 400 gig. Channelization ports add a colon and a channel number. Nothing new here. So note that interface management, including the naming, is very different on platforms running Juno Civil. What about the fabric? Both LC1400 and LC1402 require SFB2 switch fabric board in your MX10K 4 slot and 8 slot. This is a critical point. The first generation fabric cards are not supported. If you try to insert either LAN card in the chassis with a first generation fabric card, you will see offline due to unsupported fabric in a CLI. All 6 fabric cards are needed to provide a full 4.8T throughput. However, the system is resilient. There will be a linear drop in performance in the event of fabric card failure. With 5 cards, you're gonna still get 89%. Even with just 3 fabric cards, you maintain 53% capacity around 2.5T. This graceful degradation is important for planning maintenance width. The service length between each 306 and the fabric are running at 56 gig. Each PFE complex uses 18 SerDes lanes towards the fabric, giving us the 800 gig capacity per PFE that we talked about earlier. You can verify your fabric card using show chassis hardware if you want. Now let's do a quick comparison of port capabilities between the two LAN cards. The LC4800 gives you maximum flexibility with speed from 1 gig to 400 gig across different form factors. You get 4 QSFP56DD and 40 SFP56DD ports. The SFP are perfect for high density 100 gig deployments with single lambda, for example. The LC4802 focuses on QSFP compatibility. 4 QSFP56DD ports again, but this time 32 QSFP28 ports. This makes it ideal if you have existing QSFP28 inventory and accept the use of QSA for 1 gig and 10 gig connectivity or breakout. For 100 gig deployments, the LC4800 can deliver 48 ports with some breakout configuration. The LC4802 can deliver between 36 and 40 depending on the configuration. The key is to understand your optics inventory and future migration path. The LC4800 is optimized for modern, high-density 100 gig with single lambda optics. The LC4802 provides broader compatibility with the existing QSFP infrastructure. Before we wrap up, let me share some configuration best practices. First, plan your port profiles carefully. If you know all the ports will run at the same speed, you can use peak level configuration. That's simpler. But if you need mixed speed, use port level configuration for maximum control. Remember that changing peak level configuration requires a peak bounce. While port level changes are more graceful, the system deletes and recreates only the affected interfaces. For LC4802, always consider the port pairing constraints when planning 40 gig, 4x10 and 4x25 deployment. Map out your port pairs in advance to avoid surprises. For encryption, all ports support MACsec line rate. It's done with PFE directly. Also, we recently introduced the IPsec feature, 300 gig per PFE. Again, you have 3 chipsets, 6 PFE, so I'll let you do the math for the global capability per LAN card. More details are present in the article published on our TechPost platform, and you will find the links in the description. Thanks for watching. I know your time is precious. I've been Nicolas Février, and I see you in the next one.